So I will be very specifically going into understanding the Iron Age cultures in the Kuri Plateau, and it has helped us a lot to dive a little bit out of semi-arid regions. Now, in that sense, if you consider the bulk of the archaeological research studying on the megaliths of South India, it has been more concentrated on the semi-arid regions, though the earliest archaeological works started in the Nilgiris. So we have given a larger concentration of archaeological research focusing on the semi-arid regions. And now when I say semi-arid regions, it has been more concentrated on the regions of Krishna, Tungabhadra, which covers the northern part of Karnataka and northern part of Andhra Pradesh and even today's part of Telangana. And recent studies have also been concentrated in the other ecological zones, such as the tropical savanna, covering the southern part of Karnataka and some part of Tamil Nadu as well. The recent works have also been focused on the other ecological zones, including the savanna of southern Karnataka and adjoining Tamil Nadu region. And if you look at the Kaveri Basin, starting from the Kuri Plateau and the confluence in Tanjavur in Tamil Nadu, it has been a very interesting archaeological study of concern. And various scholars have worked on not only on megalithic culture, it has also been explored and studied for the Neolithic and early historic sense. So in this context, I will not go deeper into understanding either the burial types or distribution of burial types in South India. Rather, the whole point of this presentation is to understand that these semi-arid regions and the tropical evergreen forest, which receives high rainfall, is two contrasting kind of ecological conditions. I mean, one semi-arid is characterized by a very dry, very low rainfall, and that is how it has also characterized its forest and ecological conditions. So on the other hand, if you look at the Western Ghats, including the tropical, including the Kuri Plateau, here the tropical evergreen forest, which receives high rainfall, and it has made its own biodiversity itself. So the whole study of a Kuri Plateau actually concentrated with this basic differentiation, because we have been well understood from various researchers about the social stratigraphy, the economy, burial types, and burial distributions. It is understood by a series of theoretical approaches that the social system and the economy of Iron Age was somewhat hierarchically stratified, in the sense that the society was based on construction of different types of megalithic burials owing to its social status. On the other hand, in the economic theories, we can also understand that the better controlling of the natural resources surrounding the site, including the water and the iron and the space, we have to concentrate more on understanding the settlement pattern and the spatial distribution and how they occupy the site space in developing their settlements. So all this probably more or less similar, but when it comes to the economic point of view, we have two different natural economies here. On the other hand, the semi-arid, the megalithic sites or Iron Age sites in semi-arid regions are more characterized by understanding their catchment or their approaches towards water collection and water management, and the areas surrounding the middle of Tungabhadra and Krishna in the districts, prominently in the districts of Chitradurga, Ballari, and Raichur, where there are iron ore deposits and rich mineral deposits, have concentrated also for the development of high density of megalithic sites. So now the basic question is whether all this theoretical understanding about the society and economy from the semi-arid iron age sites, can it be applied also to the iron age sites in the tropical conditions? Second one is, it is also important to understand that the question of habitation sites or the preservation or the nature of settlement sites associated with the megalithic sites also remains a standstill. Even in the semi-arid regions, there are various sites. I mean, there are only few sites, particularly the multi-period sites, which are available for understanding the iron age settlements. Beyond that, we also that the very anxiety to find iron age habitation sites also sustains in semi-arid conditions as well as in the tropical conditions. When I say tropical conditions, you can broadly also consider right the western ghats of Karnataka and Kerala and part of Tamil Nadu as well. So this is another question that also there. Third one is, as you may be aware, when it comes to the prehistoric antiquity or the prehistoric cultures in the Western Ghats, we have a very abrupt understanding, because here also much more conditions have been more focused on studying the Paleolithic sites or Paleolithic sites to Neolithic sites and other historic sites as well. The much focus has been in the interiors of the Deccan Plateau. Okay, it has been much more into the interiors of the Deccan Plateau. So the second approach here is that, apart from understanding the megalithic iron age sites, what is the condition of what would be the condition of other prehistoric sites in the tropical environments? So these are some of the fundamental differences that that has been identified from past 6 to 7 years of my research, and gradually we have been zeroing down to each and every particular point of understanding. So in that context, this region of Coorg was selected, and for your understanding, the Coorg Plateau is a geological term, and it represents the Madikeri district of Karnataka, and the it is adjoining to the Wayanad Plateau or the Wayanad Reserve Forest in the south, and the Kudremukha Schist belts in the north. Now, when it comes to this ecological conditions, we can understand that the Coorg Plateau, and particularly the megalithic sites in the Coorg Plateau, are more approachable from the east or the eastern slope of the Western Ghats. Because as we enter into the high valleys of the Western Ghats from east to west, the number of sites reduces. And we can understand by the end of this topic, we will also try to understand how the site distribution is occurring at this juncture. I would like to call this location is a very strategic location, because textual references as well as other archaeological sites focusing in the other areas adjoining to the Coorg Plateau, it clearly tells us that there is some movement that is happening during the late Iron Age or during the early historic time. So therefore, this is a very strategic location where it is very rich in its biodiverse, water resources, mineral resources, and it is also has a passage to reach the west coast of India, the narrow belt of west coast of India. So therefore, this region should be understood beyond the research of megalithic types or megalithic sites. Rather, it means a very microscopic contextualization of economic and social development that is happening during the Iron Age and also in the verge of Iron Age transiting into the early historic times. And beyond all this, when the explorations were conducted in the Coorg Plateau, it was understood that there are no reminiscences of prehistoric sites. They are dating back to Paleolithic or Mesolithic or Neolithic. And even the region doesn't have a substantial evidence for the early historic development. So that is why I very particularly call this area is an exclusive Iron Age area. Whether it is called as exclusively Iron Age area, because based on the distribution of megalithic sites. And the distribution of megalithic sites are not small sites, because we have good reports coming from the megalithic sites of Vidarbha, which has substantially larger number of megaliths. sometimes 500, some reports say 1,000. But even here, in this tropical conditions, we have megalithic sites with a larger concentration of burials, and the area of the site is also high, and the density of megalithic sites is also very much interesting to study the society and economy. And that also leads us to examine what is the status of Iron Age settlement sites here. And this all will lead, if a systematic research is conducted in what we have understood, this will also lead us to understand the strategic location of this area during the Iron Age and possibly in the Anthropocene phase. So for a very general understanding, this Kur Plateau and where this Koppa archaeological research project was conducted, here the landscapes can be viewed in two terms. One is the Malayanadu. Malayanadu means it represents the mountain forest, evergreen and deciduous forest. And these are all valleys, high elevated valleys and deep valleys. We also have in the study area partial to the Mysore Plateau, and that is why we like to call this as the eastern slopes of the Western Ghats. The eastern slopes of the Western Ghats has both the combination of Malayanadu and Kanivenadu. Kanivenadu represents a very low hill range, very low elevated hill range, series of hills. And here the natural hood is actually characterized with the growth of the development of bamboo, blackwood, teak, sandal, and other trees. And as you enter into the Malayanadu, there the modern cultivation is mainly concentrated on coffee and plant matter. So with this general understanding, the eastern slopes can be understood very thoroughly by looking at the landscapes that are accessible to the dense coarse grass. So that is also called Bene in a Kurgi language, and Bene represents a kind of open country with a dense grass cover. Therefore, looking at this diversified kind of landscape, all the three kind of landscape will clearly tell us that these are not only suitable pastoral landscapes. Iron Age economy was also based on pastoralism, because some of the rock art evidences in northern India substantiate the continuity of pastoralism even in rock art during the Iron Age. So this is not only a pastoral landscape, but also it is very rich in its biodiversity, where the inhabitants are accessible to a rich wild flora and fauna as well. So this is the area that receives high precipitation ranging from 2500 to 3500 mm per annum, and the climatic conditions are very, very fluctuating, and summer would also be very humid. Now, why I am telling, why we are also focusing on the climatic conditions, the climatic cycles in this Kur Plateau is very interesting, because even the text also refers severe climatic changes that are occurring, and the other geomorphological studies concentrating on the river Kaveri in the Western Ghats will also tell us a similar story that is there in the textual reference of Kaveri Purana and other texts that were written in the regional language of the Kurgi that we have to understand. So in simple words, this is an area which is very vibrant and dynamic area for the seasonal changes as well. And that makes them, this makes the inhabitants access to abundant water resources. Now the question is what they might have done with this abundant access to water resources. Because in a semi-arid area where the water resources are mainly dependent on the springs, on the groundwater, and it has led to the economic empowerment of controlling the water, whereas in this area it is completely contrasting development. So we also have legends or text referring to the Kurg, the people of Kurg, the tribes of Kurg, and the association of the river Kaveri with the mythological stories or legends. But what interests us in understanding the mythology of this region is that the literature clearly tells us that this is an area that has abundant number of ravelets or minor streams and major streams, and Kaveri and Harangi being two major rivers, and that these rivers have been fed by quite large number of streams and ravelets. That means this also tell us to understand that how the people were accessible to these kind of rich biodiverse area. It is not only about the accessibility to the water, but also it also questions that the movement of the Iron Age people in this region could have been not very mobilized. But we may also be wrong if we try to understand the possible technologies and possible perspectives that Iron Age people might have developed. But from the mythological stories and literature of the early historic period and historical period, we understand that this is an area which has large number of ravelets, and there is also a reference. It's a kind of mythology that we have to understand. It refers to the Rama and Sita, and they were wandering in the forest. And it is argued that when the duo along with his brother, they reached this area of Kaveri, and when they reached here, it was evening, and they were advised not to cross the river Kaveri and enter into the Malayanadu or enter further into the eastern part of the western parts, mainly because they were citing that the water, the streams and the water channels are large in concentration. Mentioning about the evidence of rice or ragi in the three-legged standing jar or three-legged red polished bear with the response from the metals. This is also attested by the localites. Whenever the localites have destroyed the megalithic burials, they have witnessed the deposition of either paddy or ragi. So that tells us clearly understand that these two food crops have been a major agricultural continuity since for over 3,000 years. And even today, paddy cultivation, though ragi has been limited, but still paddy cultivation is definitely a major cultivation in the Kur Plateau and its adjoining area. Coming to the tribes and caste, particularly the tribal communities we have in the Kur, they are Erawa, Kuruba, and Kurubas are again classified into two, Jenu Kuruba and Betta Kuruba, and we have Malekuria. So what is very much important for the archaeologists to study this ethnographic panel is that their funeral practices in the last column, the funeral practices and the agriculture. What is more interesting is the funeral practices, where you can see the Erawa, they bury their dead along with rice and milk poured into the pit, though not in the pot like that or like that during the ancient times, but they are poured into the pit. Kurubas, they bury, cremate in case of children, and in case of deceased adult, they cremate. So what is very understandable here is that in terms of occupation, they have been more pastoralists and hunter-gatherers. On the other hand, they have practicing similar kind of burial traditions, though not exactly megaliths. Particularly the Jenu Kuruba community, they erect dolmens, similar to the dolmens of the Iron Age, and they have their own mortuary practices and ritualized fashion of the dolmens of Iron Age. And rice has been a staple crop that has been found from the burials, and even today, rice has been a major cultivation in this area. So coming to the recent works, there have been good number of works that have been concentrated interminably on excavation of the burials, and we have known very well that the cultural materials that are found on the burials is not very much different from any other megaliths of different ecological areas. So that is what we try to understand, that there is a similar cultural material evidences found in this Kur Plateau, but the way the Iron Age people might have adopted to this tropical condition is completely, must have been very different from that of other ecological conditions. So that is the one of the fundamental questions that we have raised to focus more on this area for further researches. It all started with Mowgli, Mackenzie, and particularly Captain Arecor. Captain Arecor identified a good number of megalithic sites in the Kur Plateau, and most of the reports indicate that they are cromlech or dolmens, and particularly the twin kind of or double dolmens were quite common, along with the schist burials. Sometimes the schist burials were also found with the double chambers, and there were there has been a good reference to the urn burials, pit burials as well. So these are some of the earliest sketches about the material evidences that were found. When these sites were excavated, it definitely was a very kind of hot debate in terms of colonial officers or colonial communities to discuss on the antiquity of the Asiatic societies. And these people very securely dated these burials to be 300 to 400 years ago, which has been developed by the local Waddas. Waddas is a community that work on the masonry or stone, and they attributed that these burials might have been erected by the local communities hardly 300 to 400 years ago. But I don't have to go much much detail into what is our understanding when we started to date, when we started to study more of the archaeological sites, including the megaliths, and they were securely understood that they go back to the Iron Age of the megalithic culture. So these are some of the very interesting works, and quite different types of burials were excavated, and we have good records also in terms of deposits in the museums. So these kind of materials, including the three-legged jars of different dimensions or different size, pots of different dimensions, and blackware, grayware, black and redware, and iron objects such as the flat axe, arrowheads, javelin, these were all quite interesting findings, because not because of its similarity, but because of its density or the amount of cultural materials that are found from the burials. In overall understanding, though we cannot say very statistically, but for the general understanding, we can come to an inference that these burials probably had a very good, rich deposition of cultural materials and combination of cultural materials, including the deposition of either rice or millet in their pots. So there has been some publications that are available in the research page that you can refer. It all started with in 2012, going back to the Kur Plateau. And the initial observation or initial agenda, initial objective of this research in the Kur Plateau was to understand and record the megalithic remains that are there. Because that was the fundamental question that was there, to what extent and to what density and to what extensional area that the megalithic sites have been spread in this Kur Plateau. So with that approach, the initial works were conducted. We were identifying good number of megalithic, small megalithic sites surrounding the large megalithic sites. So this is another development that is there in the Iron Age sites in the Kur Plateau. You will find large burial sites. I mean, the density of megaliths will be higher, but this site will also be surrounded closely with small cluster of burial sites further. So that led to further understanding that the concentration on the distribution of megalithic sites also clearly suggests that the low elevated hills were preferred and the slopes were highly preferred so that they can extract the stones or rocks for the construction of the megaliths. And what was more interesting here is that we were able to identify multiple habitation sites surrounding this one site called Kopa initially. So that led to identity collection of number of artifactual remains from the burial sites as well as the iron working locations where smelting was conducted. Though we don't have a direct evidence of furnace or smelting activities, but the traces of molten iron or ferrous mineral is traceable on the few blocks that were collected from the similar sites. So overall, what we understood from this one site at the Kopa, which is located hardly 1 kilometer to the east of the river Kaveri is that the burial space, the burial sites are definitely a larger utilized space compared to the habitation sites, and these burial sites are often surrounded by smaller cluster of further megaliths, and the distribution of habitation sites, though not in a larger space, rather in a smaller space, there have been number of distribution of habitation space. So the, what on prima facie we come to a conclusion that the movement of the people in associating with the relative economic activities or social activities led to selection of number of small spaces, and they were not this clearly tells us that it is not a clustered or focused understanding of their space. Rather, it was a dispersed settlement idea that they had developed. So later on, we wanted to expand our geographical area, and therefore we developed a multidisciplinary as well as multi-objective focus of understanding the archaeological sites in this area. So therefore, we identified, we marked an area of 121 square kilometer of area on the river banks of Kaveri. And this river bank of Kaveri is just in the verge of entering into the Mysore Plateau. In simple words, the river Kaveri origins about 1,400 to 1,500 meters above the sea level on the western ghats in the valleys, and it flows towards both towards south as well as east, and once it starts to flow into the east, it enters into relatively plains. So that was the strategic area that was selected, where it will cover the both the eastern slopes of the western ghats and some part of the Mysore Plateau and Kanive Nadu as well. Apart from this, the geomorphology or the mineral deposition is more or less same. The apart from granitic formation, we can find abundant quartz veins. Quartz veins are quite common in this area and in these hills, and they are also found often in exfoliated conditions. And the granite, as usual, due to the high rainfall area, the sediments are also often associated with decomposed granitic gravels. So these are the two chief rocks that are available. There is no wonder that we are not able to find any other kind of rocks in terms of natural rocks or in terms of lithic materials or artifacts as well. So the reference, why I made the reference to the quartz, is that in this area, the stone tools that we found are only associated with microliths, and all the microliths are made on quartz, locally available quartz. We will not come across any other materials apart from quartz or granite. So the aim of this project was to focus very particularly focus on 121 square kilometer of area, and we developed a transect survey model, and we did transect surveys, and out of 121 square kilometer of area, we were able to cover about 80% of the study area. The rest of the 20 to 22% of study area was not able to be surveyed because of the reserved forest, and the access to the remote areas was quite difficult due to the wild animals, including the cheetah. So therefore, we were able to cover about 80% of the study area. So our main aim was to systematically document whatever sites we found, particularly the prehistoric sites or early historic sites in the cultural landscapes. This, at the end of the day, after the survey, we understood that what we found exclusively in this area is the Iron Age sites, both habitation sites, megalithic sites, and habitation sites are often associated with the finding of microliths based on quartz. And later, we also aim to develop radiometric dates and develop multicultural sequence by excavating in the future. So we want to develop a subsistence and population model by processing the distinct categorical data obtained from multi stages of research. And this will also lead to develop empirical framework for understanding the human ecology and the role of geographical factors in shaping early economy and socio-politics during the Iron Age. Possibly, it will tell us a complete story on how different the nature of sites compared to semi-arid North Karnataka that we found on the in this kind of ecological conditions. So therefore, we marked 121 square kilometer of area, which is diverse in its terms of landscape, geomorphology as well, and the forest cover or scrub cover as well. So a series of transect lines were surveyed with an interval of 500 meters and 1000 meters intervals running from the north to south and east to west. So we did a very systematic recording, not only of archaeological sites, not only of cultural materials, rather we also surveyed the possible landscape changes and the modern land use patterns as well. So we also have recorded the elevation slopes or elevations of each and every transect area that we have surveyed, and it has understood that by this graph we have actually surveyed into very dynamic kind of elevated areas. But what is more important with this elevation graph is that most of the sites are located in the smaller slopes, not on the high elevated areas, except one or two sites that are found almost 920 to 930 elevation area. And we have also recorded the movement of the surveyors, the speed and the movement of the surveyors on each of the transect lines in this sense. So on an average, we were moving in a very systematic way to record possible natural as well as archaeological features. More than 1,000 points were surveyed, and we have it has been recorded also with the distribution of archaeological sites. These reports are also available in some of my publications for your reference. To be very precise now, owing to the time, I will just go as quickly as possible. Owing to the time, what we have on a summary, we have studied 39 sites, and out of the 39 sites, 26 sites are megalithic sites where you will find burials, and most of these burial sites are to be found with the larger area occupations. I mean, the site space were larger. It also means that there were high density of megaliths with diverse typology. So the types are also very diverse. We don't have any one pattern or any one kind of megalithic types that are focused in any of the sites. Rather, it's a combination of types of buildings that are found in all the megalithic sites that were surveyed. And six out of 26 sites, six megalithic sites have been excavated, and it was excavated mainly by R.A. Cole and K.K. Subbaiah and State Archaeology Department of Mysore, dating back to 1990 and beyond. So there were no recent excavations of the burials hence. What is more promising here is that identifying 13 habitation sites. And we can see two patterns in habitation sites. That is, one habitation site having access or close to multiple burial sites. And we will also come across independent or isolated habitation sites completely located away from the burial sites. So these are the two habitation distribution that are focused here. Now, if you observe the distribution of overall sites in this map, you can see that the river Kaveri is here in the middle, exactly in the middle, and most of the sites are located away from the rivers, and particularly out of those sites, they are particularly concentrated on the east banks or away from the east bank of the river. So why this happens is that if you understand the geological formation or valleys here, it becomes very clear that the right bank or the east bank of the Kaveri is relatively plain, though not completely plain, because this is a Kanive area. That means small elevated hills are there. But compared to the West Bank of Kaveri. East Bank of Kaveri is relatively plain, and the West Bank Kaveri is valley. As you enter into the West Bank, you are entering into the high elevated areas of Kurk Plateau. So this similarity is also evident. On the other hand, if we try to understand the geomorphological behavior of the river Kaveri and Harangi is within the study area, we will come to that later. But in simple words, let me tell you, this spot or this area of upper Kaveri has been a flood prone area. Particularly the recurrent flash floods have been very, very accurately recorded in terms of geomorphological studies here. So that can also be one of the reason why these people wanted to stay away from the river. However, staying away from the river will not deprive them from the water, because this is the high rainfall area and it receives rain for a longer period of time, except the humid summer. So quickly glancing at the megalithic types, we have menhirs of huge dimensions, menhirs of smaller dimensions, possible cairn burials, dolmens, particularly dolmens of different upright stones, dolmens with multiple passage or passage dolmens. Then most common and most popular here is the cyst burial enclosed with stone circles. And often you may also come across some kind of zoomorphic figures, depending on how we perceive, and these kind of enigmatic stones are also seen in the natural environments. The present association of the people is that the people have closely monitoring, or they have close access to the megalithic sites here. They are often destroyed. Whatever, though it is destroyed, we get very authentic information from these people that it can, when they destroyed these megalithic burials, they have found good deposition of rice, millet, grains in the burial. And obviously, as a nature of law, when it comes to the megalithic burials, you will find ceramics, iron objects, and also the accremated or secondary nature of the bones, skeletal remains or bones and details. There are some sites that are recent. As I told you, this Kuruba community, they erect dolmens for their mortuary practices, as well as there are other communities who erect similar kind of dolmens identical to the Iron Age, but these dolmens are used as religious shrines. These are recent constructions, but their association with the dolmen kind of structure and used for religious structure is also evident. And they have closely associated with ritualization of stone objects based on their visualization and based on their association in terms of rituals. So there is a continuity of such dolmens continued. When it comes to the occupational remains, apart from ceramics, particularly redware, blackware, and black and redware, we also find microliths and some objects like ring stones. Now, in the case of habitational remains, as in the beginning, Dr. Abhayan has pointed out, it is quite interesting to study the occupational deposition of Iron Age sites. Because one thing that we understood here is that though we come across good number of potsherds or pottery remains in various habitational sites, it is very difficult to understand the type or the fabric of the ceramics, because most of this time the fabric is worn out due to the landscape condition. It's a tropical forest cover. It is more or less wet for most of the time. With the humid conditions in the summer, we find ceramic sheds that are often worn out with its fabric. So that is one of the very challenging occupational deposition nature that we find in this site. On the other hand, the density of potsherds that we find from habitation sites are relatively lower, because in northern Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh area, habitation sites illustrate a huge quantity of ceramic cushions. Compared to that, it is very, very low density, and it has associated something to do with the landscape features. So when it comes to the land use, we can understand here that the slopes, particularly the low elevated hill slopes, Kanniga Nadu hills, they are quite commonly occupied for the construction of bungalows, and the habitations are relatively far away. I mean, they are not associated with this kind of elevated, low elevated hills, but rather they are usually found little bit in the plains and away from the slopes. So these kind of hills, you can it has been a very favorite kind of landscape for the construction of bungalows, because the boulders, the field boulders, are readily available, and the extraction of the bedrock for the slabs were quite evident here. So more often we will find burials in these kind of low elevated slopes. And there are references to the sites that are also found in the confluence area of River Haringi and Kaveri. Now let me also point out here is that Kaveri at this stage in the upper levels, because Kaveri just flows from the high elevated areas and enter into the plains. So because of this geomorphological condition, the water current of the flow of the river, particularly during the rainy season, is relatively higher, and this is known for flood prone area. So the recurrent flash floods are quite common in this area. Now, if you observe this kind of landscape, we can see two distinct characters here. The confluence area, particularly the this area, is quite highly elevated, because the river erosions, the cutting of the river bed at the bottom as well as in the sections, are quite potential. So therefore, it has made the landscape to be little bit elevated, approximately 10 to 20 meters above from the river bed elevation. So these kind of area, particularly as you see in seeing the map, these areas were used for the construction of burials. And a very careful study of sedimentology in this area will clearly indicate a high deposition of silt. So it is quite interesting that the people during the Iron Age, they made use of these kind of extreme locations for their burial construction. And you will also find settlement area or remains of the habitation remains in the on the other bank of the river. We are not sure how the movement of crossing the river was happening, but if we carefully understand the prehistoric sites across the major river valleys, crossing the river was frequent, and it was not a hindrance. So probably with that kind of development, we can also see that these kind of riverine locations were also being their particular interest to occupy. And completely contrasting to that, we can also find that the high elevated hills and the valleys were also occupied here. To the best of my knowledge, we have recorded an habitation site that is associated with the rock shelf, with a very high, located with a high elevation. For example, if you observe the area A here, the A is pointing at the rock shelter, and this site is called Gentle Rebecca. And this rock shelter has given a clear evidence of deposition of black and red here with a better preservation. And the foothill area has clusters of major megalithic sites or burial sites surrounding this area. And we will also come across the multiple locations of habitation sites, multiple locations of megalithic sites in a closer radius of area. So this tells us that their distribution pattern in the valleys is quite interesting, that they are visually visible. I mean, anywhere on the high hill or in a small hill, these sites are definitely visible. At least they are connected by visible proximity, though not to the distance. So in this rock shelter, I forgot to mention, the rock shelter is about 200 meters above to the surrounding plains, and it is located approximately in 1,100 meters above this sea level. So probably this could be one of the rock shelter, Iron Age rock shelter, that is located with the highest location ever seen in the South Indian context or South Asian context. So I was also mentioning about the east bank of Kaveri towards the Mysore Plateau and the distribution of the combination of megalithic sites and habitation sites are in this way. You will find a good number of sites relatively on the lower valleys and the slopes. And some of the locations for in the habitation sites were selected for documenting and recording the cultural sequence, because this was the habitation sites that also exhibited promising habitation settlements. On the surface, you will find microliths, the regular kind of ceramic sherds, and other material remains. But at the subsurface, we have nothing. Though the materials are very well deposited, I mean they are floated on the surface, but in the subsurface we didn't even find a single pot shell. Rather, this has been a very dynamic geological section that we have found. Now, what do we understand by this geological unit is that the 1 to 2 meter deposit of the upper layer is completely clay silt. And this clay silt is due to the wet tropical conditions that are often moved from the slopes. I mean, the deposition of sediments often moves in the slopes. And in the subsurface, in the next level, at the second level, we will hit at a layer that is composed of quartz decomposed materials. And these quartz are in a decomposed stage. They are very, very sharp. I mean, they are so sharp that just a rough touch over this section will definitely make your palm bleed. Now, what do we understand by here is that, again, these decomposed sections and the sediment deposition above this decomposed section is not very, very conducive for the settlement, habitational settlement development. Or site formation process, what we say, it is very, very tough location for it to deposit, and it will not record us in the present. That is why we also understood that the movement of sediments has also resulted in the erosion of the artifacts, and that erosion of the artifacts have also resulted in worn out fabric of the ceramics. And the lowermost level, you will come across the, again, a kind of decomposed granitic bedrocks. So therefore, this has been one of the, though we cannot generalize completely keeping this section throughout the project area or in the Western Ghats, but on prima facie, this clearly tells us that the habitation deposition is in the mercy of natural formation. The natural formation is very, very rigid for the deposition of cultural materials, but still it floats on the surface some cultural materials for our identification. Now, coming to the end part of it, I have been also mentioning about the upper river Kaveri at this location being very, very flooded. Recurrent flash floods have been seen. Even in the last 2 to 4 years, you might have those who are living in South India or who are acquainted with the information, you have also witnessed that the Kur Plateau had witnessed severe flooding conditions, which also resulted in major landslides in the greater valleys in the Kur Plateau. And in the unfortunately, in the Kerala also, if I'm right, 5 to 6 years ago, there has been severe flooding conditions and landslide conditions. I mean, well, my point here is that these are the area which is more or less similar in geomorphological and climatic conditions. Now, coming to the geomorphological records, about 20 kilometers from the study area upstream, about 20 kilometers upstream of the study area, Kale and other geologists studied the geomorphology of the river Kaveri, and there what we have understood is there has been a 6 discrete Holocene flux from dating from 8000 to 2000 years ago. And definitely first millennium BC should have been a occupational area of the Aranet people in these locations. So this area has repeatedly witnessed recurrent flash floods. And that is recordable even down up to 2000 years ago. And since the 2000 years ago, in the late Holocene to the present, the other work within the study area, and this geomorphological study area, I mean, this work has been conducted in the confluence area of Arangi and Kaveri, which I have shown in the earlier slide. And they also record same trend. What we have witnessed in the early Holocene, mid Holocene, late Holocene, and even to the present condition, this area, I mean, this river at this particular locations or geography in the upper Kaveri Valley, it has been a very, very robust. Why it is robust? Because the monsoon is very robust. It is so robust that the extreme colder and warmer conditions have been resulted here. So what is, why it is important for us to study here is that in two ways. One is the landscape formation and the accessibility of river or accessibility of natural resources for the Aranich people. Second one is the people possibly concentrating away from the river is also because of the recurrent flash floods that were occurring close to the rivers. So probably for them, the water and water accessibility was not so important. Rather, they had their own economic resources, possibly the beads, because this is the area of megaliths where in every megalith you will find the carnelian beads. Whether you say Egypt beads or bleach in the modern terminologies, but these sites have been very rich in carnelian deposition. And iron tools are highly found here. So alternative to the controlling the water, they might have had better access to the minerals of carnelian and iron to supplement their economic resources. So distribution of iron is also quite important here. We have schist belt areas in the Kudremukh, that is Chikmagalur area, what we call Sahyadri range. And in Wayanad, towards the Nilgiri hills, we have granulates, again, which are quite useful for extracting of iron. And if we move further west, towards the coastal area, the laterite formations are also useful for iron. So iron, this is the area that has been very much identified with the iron and abundant accessibility of iron as well. So therefore, to conclude, what we understand here is that certain things are very clear. The people have definitely moved away from the river, possibly witnessing the effects of the flash floods, and they have moved into the forest for better access to the settlement areas. That is why we will find more often settlement areas away from the river banks, not from the closer river banks. And the high density of megalithic sites in just 121 square kilometer of area will also tells us that the distribution of community and the social relations that was there, possibly it was in a very high density as well as they have distributed. Because the high distribution of megalithic sites in this region will also tell us that they are more intact. I mean, their social affairs and their economic activities should have been more intact and closely understood. That could have been possibly with a kind of chiefdom based politics leading to the controlling of or distribution of economic resources, particularly iron, and accessibility to the pastoralism and agriculture, including, we should not also include, access to the wild flora that also might have engaged them in frequent hunting gathering economy as well. So therefore, we have a lot of much more understanding we have to do with this understanding, so that in the future we will be able to address much more gaps that are there in the Iron Age archaeology of the Kur Plateau or in the Western Ghats as well. And this study is not only associated with the Western Ghats. On the other hand, if you look at the archaeology of the Kaveri Valley, this area is also very quite promising, because As you know, the Lower Kaveri area is known for its Iron Age or megalithic and prehistoric sites. And in the middle of the Kaveri Valley, there are some areas close to the Biligiri Hills or Enam Hills, which is also referred as Kongo Desham. The Sangam literature, it refers to Kongo Desham. This Kongo Desham is also very promising to the Iron Age sites. And what is very much, we have to concentrate more on the Upper Kaveri Valley, because we have not given much emphasis on understanding the archaeology of Upper Kaveri Valley. And in these terms, either if we can contextualize this area into the archaeology of Western Ghats, or we can also contextualize this study area with the archaeology of the entire Kaveri Valley. So therefore, this is quite, I think this is a very quite promising area. With the further research, we will be able to understand more about the landscape, settlement, society, and economy, which is very, very suitable for the tropical conditions. Thank you.